Discovery occurred on January 3rd, 2013. A comet racing toward the inner solar system had just passed the orbit of Jupiter. At the time of the discovery, the comet was 670 million miles from the Sun. That's about 7 times the distance from Earth to the Sun. Why would a comet begin discharging in such a remote, deep freeze? The first to observe the comet was Robert McNaught at the Siding Spring Observatory in Australia, thus the name C2013A1 Siding Spring. Calculations soon showed that the comet's trajectory could bring it into a collision with the planet Mars. But whether the comet's arrival would lead to a collision with Mars or a near collision, cameras on the surface of Mars and in orbit around the planet could record the event. And that possibility provoked excitement amongst comet investigators and planetary scientists exploring Mars and its environment. New calculations soon gave more precise figures for the comet's trajectory. It would not collide with Mars, but approach the planet within some 88,000 miles, well under half the distance from Earth to the Moon. Under standard comet theory, this would be a visitor from the conjectured Oort cloud surrounding our Sun in remote space. So comet scientists expected that instruments on the surface of Mars and in telescopes orbiting Mars would provide an unprecedented look at the ingredients of an Oort cloud comet. Estimates place the size of the comet at under a half mile in diameter. However, that calculation was not based on direct observation of the nucleus. It was derived initially from assumptions about water production. Astronomers just assumed that the hydroxyl molecules initially detected were created by water molecules from sublimating ices interacting with ultraviolet light from the Sun. That would require heating of the comet's surface up to the level necessary for surface ices to sublimate. Icy surfaces in Jupiter's deep freeze do not sublimate even close to the rate of water production that we observe with an active comet at such distances. That's not a fact to be ignored. And keep in mind that laboratory experiments decades ago had already demonstrated the production of hydroxyl electrochemically with no contribution from water. For electrical theorists, that's the overriding question. Would electrochemistry play a role, possibly an indispensable role, in the encounter? Well, prior to its arrival at the Martian orbit, the comet was ejecting dust at 3 times the rate projected by theory, and the velocity of the ejected dust particles was more than double expectation. That mystery has yet to be resolved. Of course, the electrical theorists were most interested in any contribution of negative charge from the comet to the upper atmosphere of Mars. On its arrival at the Martian orbit, Siding Spring was traveling about 35 miles per second, and the effects of the planet's entry into the tail of the comet were quite spectacular, an almost instantaneous explosion of electrons in the Martian upper atmosphere. Investigators speculated that this blast of electrons was due to ionization of cometary dust. The dust particles must have collided with air molecules from Mars, stripping away free electrons. But even at its surface, the Martian atmosphere is well under 1% of the density of Earth's atmosphere, and the uppermost region, the ionosphere of Mars, is an extraordinarily rarefied layer. Could ionizing collisions actually explain the remarkable changes in electron density, a sudden doubling in the electron count? We can only pose the question here since data are still sparse, but electron densities in the vicinity of comets have puzzled scientists since the first encounter with a comet in the mid-80s. That was when more than one probe reached Comet Halley to find a density of negatively charged particles forbidden by prevailing theory. Earlier theoretical challenges should not be ignored when new discoveries bring similar challenges. Could the litany of comet mysteries be due most fundamentally to a theoretical mistake, a failure to see the electrical nature of these bodies? It was the most ambitious undertaking in the history of comet science. The European Space Agency's Rosetta mission to Comet 67P Churyumov-Gerasimenko. The probe was launched on March 2, 2004, beginning a 10-year journey to 67P, arriving at the comet in the summer of 2014. Following orbital corrections from May through July 2014, the Rosetta craft was placed in orbit around the 67P nucleus. Then in August and September, onboard instruments began gathering data, including the first mapping of the surface. It would orbit the comet nucleus for well over a year, and the mission would include the anticipated touchdown of a lander named Philae on the surface of the comet. From the moment of Rosetta's arrival at 67P, investigators faced a succession of surprises, all told a challenge to every standard assumption about a comet as a dirty snowball. The unsolved mysteries included two distinct lobes joined as one by an improbably narrow neck. No appreciable water ice, even in the most active regions of the nucleus, where theory would require, at the very least, some hint of ice at the source of the comet's jets. The rudimentary molecular building blocks of the solar system billions of years ago? Nowhere to be found, though confirming such stardust in comets was an original purpose of the mission. A rock-like surface partially covered by dust, but so hard that the Philae lander bounced off the surface and was nearly lost. Fields of rocky debris scattered across the surface, all suggesting formative processes flatly disallowed by the standard theory of a dirty snowball. Exposure of cliffs with well-defined terracing, but no common orientation, just a jumble of segmented blocks as if carelessly thrown together. Pervasive small nodules that should not be there but are seen embedded in the surface relief wherever the hard surface is exposed. So-called sand dunes and wind streaks in the regions of gathered dust, with no wind available in the extreme vacuum of space to create them. A bizarre alignment of the wind streaks north to south, but no reason given for this consistent directionality. Baffling changes in the dust configurations during the period of observation, something never expected and too obviously prohibited under standard assumptions. Acceleration of voluminous dust away from the comet at velocities simply unachievable by mere sublimation of surface volatiles. Absence of any openings to the imagined pressure chambers beneath the surface, the supposed sources of the comet's jets. And no energy profiles of the jets that would be consistent with the theorized explosive release of pressurized gases. The confinement of the comet's jets in narrow filaments in stark contrast to the well-known explosive expansion of pressurized gases in a vacuum. Enigmatic electromagnetic oscillations or so-called sounds of the comet. A cloud of high-energy electrons close to the nucleus, though the presumed neutral body in neutral space gives no electrodynamic basis for such charge separation. Abundances of molecular oxygen, or O2, though this molecule is far too reactive to survive across the imagined epochs of solar system evolution. Concentrations of hydroxyl ions and water molecules in the coma, with virtually no water on the surface to account for them. From one comet visit to another, it seems that the mysteries have only deepened. But the first requirement for progress in science is to make sense of the surprises. When every major discovery comes as a surprise, that pattern demands a new theoretical framework. Comets are not what we thought. In the review that follows, we will show detail by detail that the great surprises of comet science are in fact the predictions of an electric comet model.